research is on creating a YouTube live streaming page for LGBTQ nonprofits. Tani kept challenging me as to why I'm doing this, why I'm doing this. So in the mid-1900s, you were at college and you were found to be LGBTQ. You were considered a sexual deviant and kicked out of school. In 1973, up until 1973, homosexuality was on the list of mental disorders. And then in 2013 was when same-sex marriage was legalized in Rhode Island. So you can kind of think about like how recently things have been talked. So when I was in high school, my senior year of high school, my friend Timmy, his parents found out he was LGBTQ. They called 911, they had him taken away and thrown in Butler. He just disappeared for 2 weeks, they put him on all these drugs, and then finally he came back to school. My friend Chad, when I was an undergrad, I think it was my sophomore year, he came out to his mom as transgender, and she kicked his butt. He was all bloody and gross and pretty much within inches of his life. Last year, my friend Emily, who's trans, she had a newer job, and her boss saw a picture of her and her wife on her desktop, and 2 days later, they fired her. Just last week, my friend Tim, they just kind of changed over, but he was Mr. Gay Rhode Island, was in a gas station, and somebody saw his sash that he was Mr. Gay Rhode Island, and pardon my language, they chased him out calling him a faggot, and chased him out of the gas station, and chased him in his car until he left. So this stuff is still around. Like, awareness is where the power is on how but this is why I do what I do. But if you know me, I'm very fun-loving and light-hearted, and I like to think about the positive side of things. So my son Bean was really my transformative time to think about children and how kids bring such happiness to the world. And this is really where, you know, all your thoughts and your everything starts. So from Bean, I thought about Babies for Us. And I found a few of my friends that were couples wanted to have children, but they just couldn't financially do it. It's, you know, if I've taken classes with you, I've preached about how it costs thousands and thousands of dollars for artificial insemination. And these are amazing couples that just can't have children on their own. And through my research and through creating Babies for Us, I found that most of the LGBTQ nonprofits in Rhode Island run on less than 50 grand. So most people can't manage their family on less than 50 grand, never mind like a whole nonprofit that's supporting people. Their newer organizations, all their staff is all volunteer. A lot of the LGBT groups work separately from each other. And pretty much all the groups are barely staying alive. If you think about the Pride Parade, they go into the parade in a deficit of $150,000. And they have to recoup that before they can even start to raise any money with all the good work that they do. So not only do we have to support the LGBT community, we also have to help support the nonprofits that help them. And then you think about the biggest way to communicate is through the internet. It's, you know, communication without borders. You can send information on the internet and it's hitting China and Europe, everywhere. It's a good way to be collaborative and cooperate. It's, you know, the biggest place to spread awareness and find problem solving. So some of my learnings and theories. What really inspired me to start doing YouTube was the flipped classroom. In teaching adults using technology, I was attracted to the flipped classroom and how you put all of your information online, and then when you get together, you kind of discuss what's going on with it. Androgyny, how you have to focus on adults as learners, how they have information that they're coming into, how the information that you're using right now has to be useful. Social constructivism, their base for information and building on that. And then Mesereau is transformative. So I talked about my transformative moment of having been, but a lot of the LGBT community, they're coming out as a process is kind of their transformative. And you have to kind of think about that as you're teaching also. So my objectives are to learn how to develop a YouTube live stream page, to develop and deliver a YouTube live stream page, to foster continued collaboration between LGBTQ nonprofit groups in Rhode Island, and encourage participation and increase awareness of the LGBT community. So it's a lot about awareness, and it's a lot about linking different nonprofits together. So that way, you know, you have all these small nonprofits, but what if we get together? We're so much more impactful. And to evaluate the effectiveness of that YouTube channel. So here's what my YouTube channel looks like if you go on to it. So it's Babies for Us YouTube. If anybody wants to, I was gonna put videos on, but I thought it'd be more fun if everybody just kind of went on and picked videos that they wanted to do. And also Facebook. So everything that I created, I downloaded it or streamed right to YouTube, and then I put it onto Facebook. And you can kind of tell too, like the progression of the videos. So I started off like super basic and just kind of filmed myself in like a one shot kind of thing. But I learned that it's difficult to do that. This one video that's like a minute and 43 seconds, it took me like 12 different shots before I actually did all the content that I wanted to do and like liked it. And then these, I was learning how to edit video. So these are still pictures set to music. And I learned how to make the pictures longer and shorter, depending on how long I wanted the pictures to run to use it. And then I started putting people and other people into the video. So I found that the more people that are in the video, the more shares and the more likes you get. And also creating activities. So it started off as kind of like a Martha Stewart idea that to have like an activity, like the first one's cooking, the next one was supposed to be carpool karaoke, but he didn't want to sing. So we ended up kind of driving around with like this kind of driving activity. But it was really cool too. The activities, if you do activities while you do your videos, it's really nice because then you have a go-to. Like if you kind of get that break where, you know, they say every 7 minutes there's an awkward silence. If you have that activity, you can break that awkward silence with that activity. But I didn't quite master like the awkward picture. I can't quite figure out like how they decide which picture is like your first picture in the video, so like they're all me making some kind of awkward face. And then that's my shameless plug for Facebook, so like it's on Facebook, like it's on YouTube. These are some of the groups that I've been working with, and if you've never heard of some, this is why I do what I do. So Renaissance City Softball League, Imperial Court, Rhode Island, CHRI, Rhode Island Pride, PFLAG Options, Apes Care, Ocean State. It's probably another dozen that I've been involved with or worked with at some point, but those are some of the more prevalent ones. And as far as like scaffolding goes, like a lot of people know like basically what these people do, but they don't really know in depth what the groups do. And so like that's kind of what we did. We start off with like an introduction of who they are, a basic idea of what the group does, and then build upon that, and then what kind of events they have going on in case you want to participate. And to see, I can't really see it, but to kind of see how well the information is working, I created a survey, which I kind of like to be able to see it, but this is live. So if you like my Babies for Us Facebook page, you can actually still go on this, and it just asks you to watch a couple videos, and then the questions are based off of those videos. And then I also took information from Facebook and YouTube and kind of analyzed it. By length of video, date published, YouTube views, Facebook reach. So this is kind of like a newer thing. If you have a business page, they talk about Facebook views and Facebook reach. So views is you have to actually watch the video. And then the reach is like if it's on somebody's page and they kind of scroll by it, how many people that happens. And then Facebook shares is pretty, but they're constantly changing their algorithms. It used to be that if you just liked somebody's post on Facebook, then they would start coming up more so. Now you have to actually comment on it for it to show up more so in your stream.
And then also the way that they're sharing it on everybody's stream is more, it's slower. Like, they want you to pay to share things now. So you'll see, like, when you post something on Facebook, you don't get quite as many likes in that first day that you used to, but as the days go on, you still get more. So it kind of used to be like when you see your likes, like you'll get like 80 likes in one day, and then you don't see any for a couple days. Do you know what I mean? But now, like, you'll see as the days go on, you'll still trickle in like 5 or 10. It's just from them changing their algorithm and how they're sharing the content. So what I found from my survey, which clearly you can see, is that people were learning from the content that I shared. And I asked them to say specifically what they learned from that content. And I asked them to say specifically what they learned about Babies for Us. So, and I guess my biggest finding from this is that people do want to get involved, but they don't really know what groups to get involved with or how to get involved. So, you know, it made me feel better that, like, you know, the information was getting to people. And then this kind of tells you about views and reaches. So the two big ones were like my very first one that I took like 12 tries to do. And then me and Emily did one and another intro. So there's two different intros. One's just me and one's me and my friend. Those were the two big views. I was a little disappointed that the one that we did driving around didn't get that many likes or views. But I think part of that is because of the length. So the shorter videos get more views. I got a lot of comments from the longer video from people that said, like, I watched the first bit of it, but then I just, you know, moved on. When you do research, they tell you, like, 12 to 15 minutes for an adult video, but I don't think anybody's got that attention span. You got to keep it more like 5 to 7 and be, like, really interesting for that kind of length. So the challenges. It's definitely, YouTube videos definitely make it look a lot easier than it is. Like, when you actually go to do it, it took a lot of tries, but I found it really helpful to have done that first video of just me trying to do one take, because I got used to being on camera, and I got used to seeing myself, and used to listening to yourself. Kind of like WebEx, like when you first start doing WebEx, like, you feel, like, so insecure about yourself, because you're looking at yourself while you're talking, but as you do it, like, you get more comfortable with it. There's a lot of lack of research in LGBTQ, and it's because it's kind of more recently becoming acceptable, but I think part of that too is that a lot of the acronyms are changing and the verbiage is changing to be able to search it. So, like, a lot of the older research is on homosexual, and then it goes to gay, and then it goes to LGBT. And then it goes to LGBT, and then LGBTQ. Now we're at QQ, we're at Q+. There's a lot of different different verbiage to search for the LGBTQ, but it's all very newer. That Facebook algorithm was a challenge, because you always want the most views. You want it to go to the most public as you can get it, but with them constantly changing it, and they don't like to share their algorithms because they want you to pay. That came to be a challenge. The equipment was a little bit of a challenge. At first, I was trying to use a GoPro, and we had trouble syncing it to my iPad, and then we figured out that the GoPro doesn't really sync to YouTube, and I found it to be way easier just to use my phone. The only thing I found with my phone that is, if somebody calls you, YouTube kind of just shuts it off, so that's why there's two videos when it really should just be one. And then it was a little bit of a challenge working with other nonprofit leaders as far as their schedule, as far as being able to pick an activity to do, because in my head, like, everybody can do everything. But then when you start talking to them, some people want to do some things, and other people are like, I don't cook, it's scary, or like gardening. And then also working with people, one of the videos, my friend's a singer, like, that's like his talent. But then we talked about it, and that's what we were going to do. And then when we went to actually do it, he's like, I'm not singing. He's like, I have a show in 4 days. I'm just not doing it. So you have to kind of improvise and just kind of go with it. And then some of the positive things and the creative things.
it's nice to have it up there because people can kind of view it at their own time and they can use their own devices. That's the nice thing about YouTube. In my questionnaire, I ask people like what kind of device they use. So whether they're using an iPad, like a tablet or their phone or a desktop. And most people are just streaming off of their phone. Then I talked about starting with the equipment is good and bad because it's really cheap to just be able to use your phone. And it's nice that YouTube is so accessible for everybody and it's free as opposed to having to buy some kind of app. The activities were really cool because of that. It's also a distraction from being on camera, you know what I mean? So like, you're so busy worried about like cooking or singing or whatever, or driving, that you're not so aware of what your face is doing or where your hands are. It's just all kind of comes very natural. And then it did build relationships and collaboration because you're working together with another person, do you know what I mean? Going through this experience together, it's creating that relationship. And the biggest thing that like pleased me was that viewers were inspired to get involved with nonprofits. So, you know, it makes it all worth it.
Thank you. Did you get as many anticipated views, or because of the way Facebook was acting, like you didn't get as many as you'd like? And that's my first question. And then the second question I have for you is, like, what other topics in the future do you have for you?
I was really surprised with how many views and likes I got between the first videos and the second videos, because I did some of the first videos last year when I took EDC 585, the adults using technology. So, but I think a lot of that is because of the change in algorithms. I expected a lot more views and likes this time, but because of the way that they're sharing information right now and that they want you to pay for it, I was kind of surprised that there weren't as many views. And then in the future, like I just want to be able to hit on as many other nonprofits as possible and just kind of share their information. Because every time I interact with somebody from another nonprofit, like I'm always learning from them. And I'm always surprised all the different activities and things that they do. So more of that and more sharing their events and my events.
Do you intend to continue using the YouTube live stream for Babies for Us?
I do. And actually, I was surprised in the questionnaire that people were saying they want to see the actual events. More of the actual events. So, because we talk about the events, but I didn't post any of them. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure I'm going to find somebody to be able to like live video the events now.
Another piece of that. What do you feel like you might change going forward, if anything, to make your process a little bit easier?
Not necessarily a change, but there's a lot of research on how often you're supposed to be doing the videos. So it's more that I need to get more into a routine of like videoing like every Wednesday night and every like Saturday afternoon. And that's supposed to get you more of a draw for people to view it. So you're supposed to try to find like times that like people aren't working. They say like 10 o'clock on like a Tuesday afternoon, nobody's gonna watch you. But if somebody's home and bored and they're just kind of flipping through videos, that's the time to throw things up there.
Your Babies for Us, you're obviously trying to raise money so that same-sex couples can get a child?
Yes. So okay, we deal with lesbian couples because there's laws on there's laws on impregnating somebody for that. So I'm not a lawyer, so I don't deal with the surrogacy laws. There's surrogacy laws in Rhode Island. So we raise money to help them buy semen, go through the artificial insemination process, whether it be with their doctor at home. We also do what's called tea talks, which are, we get the couples together and they kind of are a support system for each other. Because the research indicates that more lesbian couples are kind of spread out. They kind of stay within their families and kind of aren't clustered together, as opposed to male LGBT couples that kind of cluster more. So they have unique circumstances that they don't have a lot of support, and we do tea talks for that. And then we do two different kinds of events. We do fundraising events. So we're doing a trivia night. It's a rocking trivia. We have a band and trivia coming up the 17th, and then we do awareness events. So we'll do like a Paw Socks night. So we don't make money off the awareness events. It's just kind of like a family oriented event. And then we raise money.
So have you been able to produce a child for?
Yeah, one of our couples did get pregnant. They are, I want to say 4 months now. So we're working with five couples. And then the third couple is pregnant. And then the very first one's not really active right now. They're getting married soon. And then two of them are very active. It just hasn't happened yet. But yeah, one of our couples is pregnant.
Other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. I do.
Okay.
Being that YouTube is a public forum, do you encounter negativity? This is a touchy subject for some people. You see a lot of ignorance come into, you know, especially with the comment section. Have you had any negativity in the comment section, and is there a way to filter that out?
I haven't seen any negativity in comments or anything like that, but I have encountered quite a few people that don't want to be videoed and don't want their pictures involved. I have two couples that want to remain anonymous. They don't really want people knowing that they're trying. They don't really want their faces out there. And then I found with a lot of the older LGBTQ, they just kind of experienced a lot that they don't want their faces out there and just to kind of broadcast it that they're LGBT.
Final question.